Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome back to City Scripts. This is our most exciting fun session, something that we started thinking about when the pandemic shut all our libraries and archives down. So we thought, you know, usually we do a public libraries walk where we're taking people with us from one library to another. So this is our sort of attempt to bring the libraries to you. We have some friends from the IISc Archives, Madras Literary Society, the archives at NCBS, and the IFA Archive. And of course, our own colleagues from the IHS Library will be taking us through the space, their collections, and many other things of interest. So thank you everyone for joining us. We'll start this session off with Deepika of the IISc Archives. Over to you, Deepika.
Hi, Rekha, and thank you so much for the opportunity. I just want to say hi to everyone, and we have a presentation that we've prepared for you. Perhaps we could play that, and then if it's an introduction to the archives, I hope everyone finds it interesting, and if you have questions at the end of it, I'd be really happy to answer them.
Welcome to the archives of the Indian, Institute of Science, or IISc, was set up in 1909, which makes it over 111 years old. The archives were set up in 2007, ahead of the Institute's centenary celebrations. The archives sits in the Office of Communications, which was previously known as the Archives and Publications Cell. Thank you. It is managed by one full-time member of staff and three trainees, supported by admin and multitasking staff. The archives has over 1,600 books and original documents. Over 6,000 photographs, over 30 artifacts, as well as digital materials and much more. Together, these materials tell us about several aspects of the Institute's history, including about those involved in setting up the Institute, about the running of the Institute, about renowned scientists who lived and worked here, about scientific practices and research at the Institute, about famous visitors through the years, and they also tell us a little about the lives of people in various roles who form the Institute's very core. majority of these materials is collected from administrative offices, departments, or donated by individual faculty, students, staff, or their family members. At the moment, our focus is on conserving and cataloging material. This includes several aspects such as ensuring a clean, temperature and humidity controlled and pest-free environment. It includes procuring acid-free folders, boxes and containers. It includes carrying out preventive conservation with training by professional conservators. And it also includes aiming to work with professional conservators to repair and restore very old or fragile material. Processing new material that comes in, which is kept in quarantine in a separate room until it's ready to be transferred to the archives. Organizing and describing material according to the General International Standard of Archival Description put out by the International Council on Archives. Some of the archival material is already digitized, and we aim to complete this process and maintain material using an archival management system, such as Access to Memory, also known as ATOM. Our goal for 2021 is to organize existing material into defined collections and build a catalog that will be publicly available online by the end of the year. We welcome research inquiries and are open on weekdays from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. To schedule a visit, please email us at archives.ooc@iisc.ac.in.
Thank you, Deepika. Do you want to say something before we open up to questions? I have pasted a note there asking people to share their questions.
Right. Do you have any? I do want to say a very big thank you to everyone who helped us put the video together. That was a bunch of skills that we didn't previously have. So it was a nice opportunity, I guess, to step out of our daily routine as well to put that together. And it helped us think about, as opposed to think about more broadly, the work that we do and how to show it to other people. It's been really nice to be able to show this to others, especially because we don't have visitors right now. I mean, in the sense that we have an occasional visitor now and then. People get in touch and we frequently get requests. So that hasn't changed so much, but just in terms of people being able to travel from far away to come and do their research here, that hasn't happened so far. So it's been nice to sort of show people in general what we're up to and what we do at the archives. Though I have to say that the pandemic gave us a really good opportunity to sort of step back from the daily things that we were sort of trapped in, actually, and to focus. We didn't get a lot of outside requests in the first few months, after things started opening up. So we were able to really use that time productively to finish a lot of our cataloging and things like that. And I think if that hadn't happened, we wouldn't be able to show you some of the stuff that we did today.
Yeah. Great. So are you going to open up to the public? Is that part of the plan?
Eventually. We're open in the sense that when people have requests, if it's one person or two people, we just schedule it so that we have a reading room where people can come and once they request material, we bring it out to the reading room. So we make sure that, we don't have two people at the same time. Or three people trying to do their research at the same time. So we spread it out in that sense. But we certainly do have people contacting us, coming by. Maybe about 3 or 4 weeks ago, we had someone from Mysore who came down to do some research for something that they were trying to put together. So that's very much happening. That's still going on.
Great. Are there any questions for Deepika? If not, we'll move ahead to the next archive. We have the Madras Literary Society. Okay, I guess if anyone has questions, we can take them at the end, Deepika. Thank you so much.
Sure. Thank you very much. We'll catch you later, I suppose, if anything else comes up.
Yes, hopefully we'll meet sooner than later.
Yes. Bye for now.
Deepika, while we're switching over to the Madras Literary Society, there is a question on the chat. Maybe you can, do you want to take it at the end? There's a question from Amrut Raj. Have you acquired any original artifact recently?
We acquire stuff pretty frequently. So actually we have in the last couple of weeks. I'm trying to really quickly think about what we might have acquired. So in one of the slides, I showed the draftsman's tools. One of the slides in that was a bunch of tools, and there was there used to be a post at ISC for people called draftsmen. And before there were computers, their job was to do scientific diagrams, draw graphs, and that kind of thing. And two draftsmen who are retired were able to fish out their old tools that they used to use. So things like they used very specific pens, or things that look like scales and protractors, stencils to write for lettering and numbers and symbols and so on. So we actually did acquire a bunch of these small tools from them. So that's maybe the most recent artifact that we have.
Great, thanks, Deepika.
You're very welcome.
We now have Sundari from the Madras Literary Society. Sundari, will you share your presentation first, and then we'll go on to your video?
Hi, yes, I'm in. Can you hear me? This is Sarpa Sundari.
Yeah, we can hear you. Do you want to turn on your...
Yes. In the middle, I was not able to hear anything. Hi, thank you for having me here today.
Hi.
So,
it seems like your connection is a bit spotty. Maybe I'll turn off my video as well.
One set we can share. So what is I look at my video, so it's clear. Is the share visible?
Do you want to switch off your video? Your signal seems a bit bad, and then you can share your PPT after that. I think while Sundari maybe reconnects, Venkat, is it okay if we move on to you? We can come back to Sundari Venkat. Folks, can you move Venkat to a panelist, please? Hi, Venkat.
Hi, hi. Yeah. Hi. Sorry. Yeah, no, that's totally fine. We can do that. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
Just a second. Okay.
There you are. Hello.
Okay. There should be a couple of other people as well, if you could have them as panelists as well. Those would be Ravi and...
Yeah, he has joined as a panelist.
Okay, great. Yeah, I think you can go ahead and start with the video and then we'll come to the... I think you guys have the video. Hi, everyone. My name is Venkat Srinivasan, and I'm part of the team at the archives at the National Center for Biological Sciences in Bangalore, India. And I wanted to thank the team at CityScripts for inviting us for this virtual tour. I'll give a quick introduction and then I'll hand it over to Ravi and Neha, who will do the virtual tour for this session. So the archives at NCBS is a public center for the history of contemporary biology in India. By contemporary, we mean roughly 200 years, and we mean roughly South Asia, of course, and biology in a very, very broad sense of the word. But I do want to stress on the word public, which is to say that we are a collecting center from the broader public for long-term preservation and access. And many of our papers are actually from members of the public. So just something to keep in mind as we go forward. This is a quick look at the website. I'm not going to go through the details, but this is the link, archives.ncbs.res.in. And you can click through the variety of sort of tabs that are available. One of the tabs is titled Collections. And collections should take you to the overview of the collections that are processed and accessible to the public. As you can see, there are about 18 collections that are available, which translates to about 50,000 objects from a variety of different media and themes, manuscripts, photographs, negatives, artifacts, which include equipment and paintings and art artifacts, and also an oral history interview repository. We've shared a couple of our featured collections, which are the Sankaran papers and the Siddiqui papers that you can have a look at. Another way to look at the catalog in detail is you can, of course, click through any of those links there, or you can go to the catalog page directly. And this is a link to the Sankaran papers, as you can see. And this is the full sort of finding aid, the structure for the Sankaran papers. Now, the material, if you want to have a look at it, if you want to know how to cite it, there's obviously there are links that you can use to cite it. And if you need to actually access the material, I'll just tell you about how to do that in a little moment. This is, for instance, what you might get when you do a search for the word Mahabaleshwar at the archives catalog. And you'll see a variety of different kinds of things. You'll see posters, you'll see seminar details, you'll see photographs and so on and so forth. And once you're done with that, this is the link to the researcher application form. There's an about page, archives.ncbs.res.in/about, where you'll see a link somewhere in the middle of the page for a form called the researcher application form, which is all that you really need to fill up and send it over to us. You don't really need to be in Bangalore to reference material, so you can use the catalog and send us these queries from any part of the world, and we do service requests regardless of where you're located. So that's just something to keep in mind. A quick look at the front door of the archives, just so that you can start thinking a little bit about, you know, what are the different languages in which the word archive can be written, what do they actually mean and such. But I won't give you more details because that's something that Ravi and Neena can actually take you through on a larger tour of the space. But I do want to wrap up with a couple of notes. One, I love to share stories from the archive, and this is something that I was seeing a few days ago. And this is a postcard from 1991 from a person named Hemant to Obaid Siddiqui, where he says, "I'm fond of collecting autographs and the writings, handwritings of, quote, eminent scientists." And he's asked Obaid Siddiqui to send an autograph. Obaid Siddiqui was one of the faculty members at NCBS and also the co-founder of the space, besides being the founder of the molecular biology unit at TIFR. So, and very widely renowned in his work. And so I guess Hemant wanted to reach out to him to you know, get his autograph. Unfortunately, it doesn't look like Obaid actually replied back, because we have the self-addressed postcard at the archives. But I'm sharing this with you because we do have an archive. We have a postcard at the archives, and you know, we'd love to sort of share this. And I think this sort of captures the philosophy of the archive, which is really for us a space to find, tell, and share stories. And this was a postcard that was made by Riya Patel, who worked with us a couple of months. And we would love to give a few to you when you come visit, pick it up during your visit when you're here. But if you're out of town and you can't make it over here, I hate to say this, but do send us your address via email, I guess. and we'll reply with a postcard and we'll throw in a few bookmarks or something like that. But just come and hang out with us, you know, and we'd love to just get a little, learn a little bit more about what you do. So to wrap it up here, if you want more links, there is a virtual tour that you can also take in your own time. The link is given there on the screen, bit.ly/archives-ncbs. And if you want to get a larger overview of the archive, you know, a couple of pages about what it has done over the last couple of years, what it's doing, what it's thinking of, there's an annual report that is available on the web where you can just go down to page 150 and that will take you to a section on the archives itself. So that's about it from my end. Just a couple of quick notes around visiting. The usual public hours are 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. Monday to Friday, but due to the current restrictions for COVID-19, for visits, we do request that you schedule an appointment because we do need to log your data and before you're able to come in. So we do need some prior notice. And for that, you need to send an email to archives@ncbs. And that's about it, really. So I will now hand it over to Neha and Ravi for the actual tour of the archives. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Venkat, for the introduction. Standing in the amphitheater, I welcome you all. My name is Neha, and today I'll be taking you on the virtual tour of archives at NCBS. And now let's walk towards the archives. Now moving towards the archives, you can see the very first poster of archives titled Find, Tell, Share Stories, welcoming you once again. The very first space inside the archives is reception area. And here, I'll quickly tell you what we have. In the front, we have some books which are part of archives library, meaning we don't issue the books, but you are most welcome to come here and read them. Along with the books, we also have archival equipment on the display, which belongs to Obaid Siddiqui's lab. On the right hand side, you can see the colorful poster wall. The posters belongs to our archives monthly public lecture series. If you want to learn more about them, please go to Archive's website and click on the events. Now, moving on, we have two reading rooms, and here we are entering the first reading room. And the very first thing you notice here is the collection of shells by K.S. Krishnan. Moving on the left hand side you can see the closed bookshelf which holds the oldest book in archives we have. Here we have the first book published in 1913 in German language and the other a textbook of physics published in 1939. Next to this bookshelf we have one open bookshelf which again is a part of archives library. These books were part of Obaid Siddiqui's lab. Moving on to the third bookshelf in the room. It is the one which is curated by Obaid Siddiqui himself. The sequence and arrangement has not been changed by us. We have just played around with the empty space for showing his lab equipments and also his laptop. And now we'll be entering the second space, reading room 2.
So as you can see, there's a bunch of objects that we've just kept as a curatorial display.
And here you see the researcher's space and the recording room in front. As Archives is open to public, so is the recording room. Archives also have used the recording room for his oral history project and podcast. The right side wall have Drosophila images which are undated found from Obaid Siddiqui's lab. And now we will be going inside the storage area of archives.
The recording room is open to the public, by the way, to do podcasts. It's a soundproof room. So do check out and call us.
So as we are inside the storage area, I've already pulled out some record to show you what we have in archives. And also, let's take a walk around the storage area. And here on the tables, we have sorted but uncatalogued collections, compactors, and equipments.
So the archives is based in a space that used to be a lab many years ago, and it has been repurposed as an archive.
And the first material you are seeing here is K.S. Krishnan Field Diary from the collection named after him, K.S. Krishnan Papers. The second material is a photo album from NCBS publication collection. It's of council meeting organized in 2002. Here we have the main building photo of NCBS and a group photo with Obaid Siddiqui.
So the fun thing about this photo is actually it sort of probably captures the entire faculty, staff, and students. It's not a very big center at that time. So in a way, it sort of just gives you a quick snapshot of the whole campus in one go. But we do keep material from the public as well. As example, as evidenced here, the Ravi Shankaran papers are from the public.
We also have equipment which belongs to Obaid Siddiqui's lab.
Fun fact, some of them are 50 years old and they still work. So the entire space is roughly 2,000
square. Now I'll be taking you towards the sorting room and the exhibition room.
Very often students pre-pandemic just used to use that divan to just come hang out and sleep. So people are welcome to do that as well.
And now we'll be moving towards the exhibition room. This is the second exhibition inaugurated on 14 Feb 2020. The curator of the exhibition is Anna Spodek. The designer is Abhishek Ray and Maitrika Design Collaborative. And the writer is Gayatri Vaidyanathan. Exhibition titled Herbs, Maps and Medicine is an exhibition of commerce and spice. Now let's take a walk around the exhibition.
Again, the exhibition is open to the public, so if you want to come visit, just send us an email, archives@ncbs.res.in. It's in the chat window. It's open till about a month from today. Curators basically designed the space as a marketplace of knowledge, essentially, which is how they sort of constructed things around that. And they've used material from about a dozen different archives from different parts of the world.
Opposite to the exhibition room, we have the sorting room. Sorting room is a place where we bring the material, clean it, sort it, and put it in the archival boxes to be taken inside the storage area. And now let's go back to the reception. And here we have a visitor book for the feedbacks, but for this virtual walk, please do give us the feedback virtually over mail. And as Venkat has told you about the postcard, that if you're out of town, please send us the address via email and we will reply you with a postcard. Thank you everyone for your time. We are looking forward for the Q&A.
Thank you, Venkat and Neha. That was really, it was so cool. What did you guys wear a camera and just sort of walk around and film it? It was really amazing.
Yeah, that's all Ravi and Neha's work. They were trying it out. So yeah.
Very cool.
They're probably very frustrated with me right now because they probably did like 100 takes.
No, it was very cool. Thank you so much. There is a question in the chat. It's, I don't know how direct it is, but yeah, it's basically people asking for some sort of housekeeping tips for the library for dust control. If you'd like to address that now, that's fine.
Not personally, not much of an expert in this, but in general, environment control is how it is. I mean, so if you're able to keep relatively stable microclimates for your material, so it doesn't really matter if your room does not have like strong conditioning, but if you're just able to keep boxes inside bureaus, you know, if one doesn't have money, it's relatively simple that way to just, you know, minimize the amount of dust or any other sort of environmental impact to the material. But we can talk about it at length depending on what the specific thing is. For now, I mean, just one word, just keep stuff inside stuff. That usually takes care of most of the issues.
We're going to take you up on your offer, though, of dropping by. I know I've been threatening it for a while, but haven't actually done it. But yeah, definitely. But we'll write ahead so that we don't violate your guidelines. But yeah. You can expect a bunch of us to show up soon.
Please do. No, it'll be nice. And, you know, we, as I said, you know, we do have this exhibition, which unfortunately not as many people have seen as we would have liked. So we have extended the schedule for this. But we will be wrapping it up in about a month or a little over a month because... we will be starting another exhibition soon after.
So. Okay. Great. Thank you so much, Venkat. We'll move on now to Sundari and the Madras Literary Society team.
Sure. Thanks. Thanks so much for having us.
Thank you, Neha. Sundari, are you online?
Online. So I'll be talking after the video is done. So Neha has the video.
Did you want to share your presentation before? I thought you said you wanted to share a presentation. Do you want to share?
Since the internet was not yes, the internet is my choice. I mean, my connection. The video, I will do that at that part, and we can save.
Okay, so we'll play the video. Thanks, Sundari.
Yes. You can make it.
I'm so happy to be here. Yeah. Taking you all around. I wish it was a live experience, but I hope to make this online trail as interesting as we would for the physical trail. So let's go in. Is the Madras Literary Society's interiors. One of the most striking features of the interior of MLS is the double story height tall shelves. And whenever we talk about these shelves, people ask how is the access, how do people go up and all that. But before all that, there will also always be this wow factor. Wow, how is this, or how is this possible, or how is it that. So this is completely made of wrought iron. When you look at the outside, it is the Indo-Saracenic or the Rajasthani style in few parts of it. Inside of it, this particular part will be the industrial style. But also if you look at the woodwork, it's intricately detailed. Each of the beams are intricately detailed. So to explain, columns are the vertical support. Beams are the horizontal support, the ones that you see here. You can see a very similar detailing in the Kanimara library as well. So talking about the building, it is a cruciform structure, which means it is like a plus. So we entered through one. You can see another door here. There is another door here and another door here. So there is enough cross ventilation and lighting for this entire structure. And apart from that, there are other few interesting aspects, which is the pulley, which you can see here. So for all those who wondered how do people take the books up and all that, you can see a metal pulley there. So that is how people, when they walk, they can go up, put it in a bag. It is a functioning pulley. We still use it to take books up and down. And talking about this particular part of the library, it is important to mention about the different projects which are going on. One of it is the cataloging projects, in which Chitra ma'am, Vinu sir, Radhika ma'am plays a major role in doing the cataloging, and they do it every week. And that's what the numbers you see. It is the MLS decimal system, and you can see the numbers as well. So this gives you an easy access to find the books, find the authors according to the title and all that. So that's used, whatever you see. You see the numbers, I see a lot of hard work. And these are all our restored book signed copies and all that. So we have something called the Adopt a Book Scheme, where someone can adopt or pay for the restoration of a particular book or digitizing a particular copy. So their name will be credited on the first page. This was started by Mr. Rajit, who was a committee member and also one of our members who initiated the fascinated about, which is the vault, which is the MLS vault. Yeah, it is locked. Yeah, so it's a two-way lock, and this has been here from the inception of the library. So this used to be one of the main entries, that's why you have the vault here. And this is a larger part of a pigeon box, but we've just put a small piece here to have a reminder of how things used to be. And if you see this side, you can see a big wrought iron metal frame. I'll add a picture to it. So you can see Middlesbrough, England engraved in the metal part. So that is another interesting part of it. And architecturally, it is the Madras Terrace roof. And flooring, we have stone flooring. And then it is the lime plaster finish. And then you have towering furnitures like this. Most of these furnitures are made in the site, which means they can't be taken out of the door, which means the wood pieces came in and people were working.
Hi, I am Vinayagam from Madras Literary Society. I am standing here one of the historic library in Chennai. I am working here as a library assistant more than 20 years. When I come here before 20 years back, I feel it's a very huge historic place in Chennai. So I love this place very much, as well as that old buildings, like a old buildings. And I feel here acoustic effect in this library, inside that library. Actually, when you come here physically, you feel that effect. One thing I tell you about acoustic effect. When you sing here, you feel that effect. For example, da sa sa da pa ma pa da da pa ma ma pa da da sa da pa ma pa da da pa ma ga ri sa. You feel that sound? When we practically you come here and you feel that effect. It's a very beautiful place. As I feel, you just come and see that feeling.
A short run through of what MLS is, and like any other historic structures or heritage building, MLS has gone through different phase and different types. Like Vinayagam sir mentioned about the acoustics of it. So those are all recent developments. So that's with that. If you have any questions, I will be happy to answer. So waiting to welcome you all in person to our library. Of course, with appointments due to the pandemic.
That was a fantastic video, Sundari. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And
the team was just sharing.
I think some pictures. Hello?
Yeah, please go ahead. We're just sharing your PPT. Please go ahead.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Renata. Thank you so much. Sorry about the internet. So we wanted to add Vinayagam sir's bite about MLS in the video for two reasons. Because whatever you see in MLS as historics, apart from the books, apart from the valuable books we have, I think maintenance of the structure and need for adaptation once in a while with the restrictions of a heritage structure is immense. So I thought I'll just show you some pictures about how the library has adapted itself in this 212 years. When we talk about maintenance, and there are so many questions. People ask us why isn't there an air conditioning? Why can't you have air conditioning and all that? But the design, the structure is something I wanted to emphasis on this entire presentation because of the double seat windows and also the clear story structure, which is the double height of the building, the double layered windows, and the placement of the windows, placement of circulation, and the spacing between two shelves, the wrought iron, the metal shelves, all that actually facilitates maintenance of the book. Because when we talk about air conditioning, we need 24 hours air conditioning, but the lime plaster finish of the structure, the exposed brickwork aspect of it, and the Madras terrace roof by itself facilitates the books to be maintained. Of course, regular maintenance, preventive conservation is 100% necessary. But one point I wanted to emphasize on the video and on the presentation is that the structure itself is in a way securing the books and the precious materials. But what is something we started doing years before is having a lot of events in MLS which are based on literature, which are for children, which are for different age groups. And this is something where it was a Michaelis concert, where having events which are sensitive to the space at the same time in which the entire structure was designed for a library as well as a place to share knowledge and get knowledge. Yeah, we can go to the next image. Yes.
Your audio is breaking a lot, Sundari. We can't hear you at all.
That's why I was just sharing how events enhance the space and how having different user groups are important.
Thank you for that, Sundari. I was your campaign on, I think it was called, what, 30 Days of MLS on Instagram. Such a lovely campaign. For those of you who are tuned in here, if you're on Instagram, take a look at the Madras Literary Society's page. They've come up with a really nice campaign that talks about different facets of the MLS itself. It's really wonderful. Great. So if there are no, somebody's question for the MLS team from Venkat. Love the intent and feel of the MLS space. Thanks for sharing. A, is the building a protected structure and who owns the space? And B, would your efforts be eligible for conservation funds that are usually available through the National Archives of India? Can you take that question, Sundari? Venkat, I think we'll share your question with Sundari. Her signal seems to be really bad.
Sure. That's fine. Later. Yeah. Thanks so much.
Is it audible now? If you can hear me, I can just answer the question.
Yes. Please go ahead. We can hear you.
Okay. Thank you, Venkat. Thank you for the question. It is a grade one heritage. It is protective. The interesting part is this particular structure was designed to house the Madras Literary Society. I didn't touch much upon the history part and concentrated on the architecture part because most of the history part is covered earlier as well. So for the College of Fort St. George, which was one of the first institutions in Chennai, so they wanted to have, they started collecting a lot of objects and books and archival material. So this was started, this building was even designed to have Madras Literary Society. So that's one advantage of what protection has. And also the building belongs to the government, but we have taken care of by the public work departments. There is a committee, MLS committee, which takes care of regular maintenance and maintenance work and all that. We are, I was telling, we have a 30-day campaign, and we also have immediate project of taking the maintenance work. So we are tenants. The Madras Literary Society is tenant to the building, but this building was designed for the Madras Literary Society.
Thank you so much. That's fantastic. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sundari. Thank you so much. If there are no other questions, we'll move along to the IFA archives. Hi, Spandana, welcome, and thank you for joining us at City Scripts.
Thank you for asking us to join you, and that it's a great opportunity for us to actually talk about what we do here. Should I start? Can you hear me? Okay. So I would like to welcome all of you from the IFA Archives team. I am Spandana, and I have my colleagues Pranav and Ria with me here today. And together we would like to take you through the IFA archive. But first, a brief introduction perhaps about the place. As some of you may know, IFA, the India Foundation for the Arts, Bangalore, is an independent, not-for-profit, grant-making and project-implementing organization that works in the field of arts and culture in India. It was established in 1993, and we made our first grant in 1995. Since then, till now, we have supported more than 650 grants and projects. So in 2015, when we reached our 20th anniversary of grant making, we were thinking of how to celebrate this milestone. And of course, the first idea was to have a grand party, you know, and invite all our past and present grantees, staff, and trustees, and have a gala. But soon we realized that that will just be one night, and then there will be nothing. We all wanted something more, something to make these 20 years of work that we and our grantees did to be out there, available and accessible. And that is how the idea of creating an archive came into being. It was sort of a gift to ourselves and to the arts and culture community all around us. We believe that the IFA archive represents a history of varied readings and studies on the arts and culture in India, with its turns, shifts, and fractures. We would like this space to be a platform to explore and experiment with the work that's already done and create new discourses. We just completed what we call the phase one of the project, where we processed and made available 10 years of material online. The physical archive, though, has the first 10 years, 1995 to 2004, along with the 10 years, 2006 to 2015, that we have already processed digitally. And now that I have started talking about the physical archive, I would request to play the short video that my colleagues Pranav and Ria created for this occasion.
Welcome to the IFA Archive. Through this video, we hope to give you a glimpse of our space. The IFA Archive was publicly launched in October 2018. Though it's a work in progress, the online archive currently has over 300 plus grants and projects supported by IFA over the years 2006 till 2015, while the physical archive has more material. As soon as one enters the IFA archive, there's a visitor's room from which one can access our database to find material both online and offline. There are certain protocols in the IFA archive policy that one has to follow while in the visitor's room, and it will soon be up on our website. For now, we've curated some material which we have received over different projects that IFA has supported over 25 years. Since this is a virtual walk, we're happy to take our visitors to the stack room of the IFA archive, which is usually out of bounds for anyone other than the IFA archive team. The stack room holds our physical material, which is both temperature and humidity controlled. It is checked regularly under the supervision of the team. Lastly, we will have a look at the conservation room, where the team works on cleaning and preservation of the older and fragile materials. We use certain material for the preservation of our documents, like acid-free paper, archival clips, archival boxes, and other tools that you can see here for the preservation of the material. Chat about the online archive and how it works for us as a collaborative space for both IFA and our grantees for showcasing grants and project materials. Somewhere along this walk, we're also hoping to show our visitors some of the materials from the IFA archive that personally resonate with or had a significant impact on one or more of our team members.
Thank you. Like we promised, we would like to take you through some of the projects that I and my colleagues, we personally connect to. So we decided that each of us will talk about one project. So I would invite Pranav to share his. Over to you, Pranav.
Hello, everyone. Am I audible? Yeah.
Yes,
so,
yeah.
Yeah, so hello, my name is Pranav and I'm part of the IFA Archive team. So today I'm going to speak about, so actually all three of us are going to speak about a grant which we found very, it's a special place in all our hearts over here. So I'm just going to share my screen over here for a minute. All right. Yeah. All right. So, okay. Can everyone see the screen over here? Yeah? Hello?
Yes, we can see your screen.
All right. Great, great. Fantastic. So today I'm going to talk about a certain grant which I found very special. So in order to go through that first, I'm just going to take you through our IFA Archive website over here. So this is our website. It's www.theifaarchive.org. And as you can see, we have plenty of stuff happening over here. So it's starting with search engines. We have a basic search, advanced search. And as you scroll down, you can see search and you're divided into six areas. That's year, program, discipline, region, geography, language. So we want to search. So these are the places and timelines where we had the grants. And some you can search them by region or year or discipline and goes on. And if you scroll a little towards the bottom, you'll see this banner which keeps going, so it's scrolling. That sort of gives the update of the last five grants we have uploaded in the online space. So moving on to the grant I was talking about. I'm just going to advance search over here for a bit. So the grant I'm going to talk about today is one of Mr. Jay Krishnan's brilliant. The grant was conceived in 2015. I'm going to click on that. And it was an arts research grant. And I'm going to see here. I think you know what? I think this should suffice for me searching for this. So 2015 arts research. Okay. There you go. So this is the grant I was talking about. So read more about it. So Jayesh's Gharanin created a film called Palai. It's it's a Tamil word for waste.
Sorry to interrupt you. Your audio is really scratchy. I don't know if you have a headset or something on. It really sounds quite difficult.
Yeah. All right. Is it all right this is now? Better.
Yeah, this is better. Thanks. Yeah.
It's better? All right, okay. So Jay Krishnan Subramanian created this grant, created this film called Palai, which sort of talks about the migrant workers, which goes from South India to the Middle East, like the UAE and other Middle Eastern countries. And it sort of deeply talks about all these emotions like separation, uncertainty, loneliness, and I personally relate to it because I come from a second generation of family, migrant family who went there and came back. So I really it was something else when I was working on this grant, and we also have plenty of material on this. So right now we have a couple of images from this particular grant. And the film is beautiful. I think many of you over here at IIHS have seen this film too. And it's the landscapes and the emotions involved in it. It's just brilliant, honestly. And okay, yeah. And another aspect of this film is how it sort of relates to the Sangam literature, the Sangam poetry. And that sort of creates a sort of bridge between the past and the present and the contemporary, contemporary aura of it. So, yeah, that's what I wanted to talk about today. I'm going to hand it over to Ria next, who will speak about her favorite grant. Ria?
Yeah. Hi, everybody. Pranav, could you share the Grant.
Yeah, sure. One minute. Yeah.
Hello, everyone. Yeah. So I'll be talking about a grant made by IFA in the year 2006. This was to theater director Sunil Shanbhag. And this was a dissemination grant, which was made to him to help him widen his audience based for his play Cotton 56 and Polyester 84. He had received an earlier grant from IFA as well in 2005 to create the production of this very play. And this play brought to light the suppression and marginalization of the mill workers. It was based on the struggles and it was based on the struggles of these mill workers who lost their jobs during the textile strike that happened in the 1980s in Mumbai. The research of this play was done by interviewing these mill workers, and also the writer who wrote the play also attended live courtroom sessions. He met the mill land activists, trade union leaders, lawyers, media people. So while the play was taking form, Sunil Shanbhag thought, how could he take the play to the mill workers themselves? So while working on this grant, what struck the most to me was that how could the art reach the source of the art as well? And I think that's what makes it special for all of us here at IFA. Was when the grant was taken to the mill workers themselves, and how they resonated when the play was performed for them. So Sunil Shanbhag took the play to the rural parts of Maharashtra, like Aurangabad, Osamabad, Rajpura, Nagpur, etc. And some of them who were already part of this mill strike, some of them were elderly mill workers, who then resonated and spoke about their various struggles that happened. And it was the play for them was like, and I quote, was like seeing our lives in flashback, like in the films for them. So I think that's what makes this grant special, because we at IFA hardly make dissemination grants, but here it was all about taking the grant back to the people it was about. So, yeah, and this is what made me happy and satisfied about the kind of work we do here at IFA. So, yeah, you can also see some of the materials we have. We have a short video clip as well about the first 5 minutes of the play as well, and some of the images of the workers looking at the play and their reactions. So, yeah, I'll be handing it over to Spandana now.
Thank you very much, Riya. And just to add to what Pranav and Riya both said, the film Pranav was talking about, the first 5 minutes of the film is also there in the archive, online archive, and the full film is with us. So if you want to see it, you can get in touch with us if you want to see the full film. And the play as well, there's a full recording of the play with us, but we have to, due to the restriction of available space on the online archive, we only put the first 5 minutes out there. So if you want to watch the full thing, you can get in touch with me. I have just posted the email ID where you can write to us. I would like to talk about this grant that we made to Shashwati Talukdar. Pranav, would you
I'm
please?
I'm opening it.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
Shashwati was... Search with Shashwati, maybe?
Yeah.
So Shashwati Talukdar got a grant from IFA under the Arts Research and Documentation Project in 2011. She was going to work with the murals on the walls of Guru Ram Rai Darbar, Dehradun. Do you want me to do screen share, Pranav?
That'll be better.
Just finish that, I'll share. Thank you.
Thank you, Spandana and team.
Yeah, just give me 1 second. I'm sorry. Pranav seems to have some sort of a issue with finding the page. Yeah, can you see this?
Yeah, we can see it.
Yeah, thank you. So Shashwat's work, as I was saying, was on the murals that one can find on the walls of Guru Ram Rai Darbar in Dehradun. So as you can see in this grand description, Guru Ram Rai was the eldest son of this seventh Sikh Guru, Guru Har Rai, and he represented him in the Mughal Darbar of Aurangzeb. When he had to leave the Darbar after 14 years, he got a huge land from the emperor at the Doon Valley, and he made his abode there. The murals that were made, but were made in phases. So the process lasted from 17th century to mid 19th century. And there's a deep underlying politics of representation, style, story chosen, artists versus funders and viewers and so on. But all these you will be able to find in the description and the subsequent reports and documents that are there. But this is not what made this grant special to me. See, the IFA archive is slightly different from the other archives in one aspect. We have material from the past, but we are also creating material every day as we keep making more grants. Since the archive started its journey, we are constantly trying to make these two ends kind of come together. What gets created out of our support, the grantees have complete right and control over the stuff. It is finally up to them to actually decide what they want to share with us and what they want to share with us privately and publicly. So there's a part that they can say that this is a private material and I don't want people out of IFA to take a look at this. And there could be material that we can freely share online and offline with our users. So we started talking to our grantees and collaborators. We try to explain what kind of work we are doing at the archive and how it kind of helps them to showcase their work in turn. And for that, what support would we like to have from them? But when you look at the older grants, there are little or less material because the idea of an archive was not there anywhere. And IFA never thought of itself as a place where they want to collect all the stuff they have funded. And so whatever we got is what the grantees wanted to share with us. And when we tried to trace these grants, went back to some of these grantees, sometimes we saw that the artists have moved on. Maybe it was just a small part of their, you know, creative life. And they've forgotten about the work they have done. They have kept no record. They have lost things. People have retired from organizations and a new person who has come in his or her stead has no idea about what happened 15 years ago. In a couple of cases, we have lost the person. They are no more with us. So Shashwat's grant actually became very special for me in this aspect. We already had some images and a copy of the film as well as some of the media reports that she submitted when the grant was closed. When we got in touch with her, she got really excited and she said, I have, you know, I have, there are lots more, you know, there are the essay that came out, there are more reviews, there are more media reports, you know, I'm doing this and that. She told us how the work actually became bigger and went deeper than what she expected it to be and how it was received, how it is kind of still going on and how it influenced the later work that she was doing. And when we were chatting about this, I asked her whether she would like to, you know, write a note about this, how this thing has actually shifted from what it was at the beginning. And she very happily agreed and she gave us kind of a personal commentary on the work she did. And it was she standing here after kind of 10 years, looking back at what she was first proposing and how it turned into something else. And it was great. And we uploaded that note with her deliverables. It's there in the PDF. If you go there, there's a PDF which actually talks about how she she looked at the work and how it has changed. There are also, of course, a lot of photos, a clip of the film, and then links of her other media coverage and press clips. So what happened here is that this actually became a collaboration between the artist and the archivist. See, our responsibility as we look at it at this archive is primarily to keep the material safe, make them accessible, preserve them in a way, and then try to make space for new experiments on top of this. But we depend on the artists and the researchers to provide the material that would represent their work well. I feel that the artist too has to think about how to represent their work in its multiplicity, especially for the cases where they cannot or wouldn't like to share the full outcome online. For example, the films, if you have a book that's getting published, you wouldn't be able to share the whole stuff online, right, in an archive. You may not want to share a full performance online, because if you are still performing it in various places, you may think that people would not like to come for the live one if it is already available online. So it becomes a challenge in these cases to represent the work in it, in all its nuances, the process, the actual outcome, and how it became what it became. So I'm not saying that we actually could represent Shashwati's work here in its entirety, but we at least tried, and it opened up a conversation, a dialogue between us and her and the archive itself, sort of. And it created an exciting exchange between the art, the artist, and the archive. I would like to think that as we go ahead, we become better at this conversation, not only with the creators, but with the users too. And on that note, I would like to end this presentation today. Thank you, CityScripts and IIHS, to give us this opportunity. And that's all for me.
Thank you, Spandana. That's it was so interesting to see how detailed your documentation process. Actually, can you stop screen sharing?
Yeah, I'm trying that. Sorry.
Ah, okay. I was just looking to see. Yeah. There you are. Yeah, it's such a detailed documentation process and different things coming out of good quality documentation as well. That's very, very interesting. Thank you so much for taking us through your archives. And I guess we have to write to you if we want to come and visit. Is that the same thing with...
Also, you can give me a call if you have my number. I don't know. And we will see what we can do. Yeah.
Sure. Great. Thank you very much. We'll move on now to the last... participant at this session, and that's the IHS Library, which is going to play a short film.
Welcome to the IHS Library. As individuals that love books, our libraries have a place of pride in our living rooms. Did you ever consider that libraries are the living rooms of our communities? In that context, we begin to understand how important spaces like these are. At IHS, the library is not just a place to read and borrow books. It's a place for people to come together, spend time, exchange ideas, and make it their own. Since our library has been closed to the public due to the pandemic, we thought of bringing the library to you. Although we are part of an educational institution, we are open to the public. This means that you don't have to be a member, a student, or part of our staff to access the library. You can just walk in, enjoy our books. You can also recommend books and films that you think we should have. Now, a bit of history before we begin our tour. The IHS Library was started with the goal to be the largest reference library on urbanization in South Asia. We want to build a specialized interdisciplinary collection on various aspects relevant to the urban transition in India and countries in the Global South that can help students, academics, and practitioners.
This is the front desk, which is the one-stop shop for everything. You can borrow books Inquire about our catalog and talk to a staff member if you need help with any of our material. We have a collection of over 22,000 books, 1,200 films, 700 maps, 630 bound volumes of back issues, and 52 case studies. Our print and electronic resources include journals, reports, data, films, maps, databases, gazetteers, teaching aids, and software. More importantly, the IIHS library provides access to full-text e-journals across various disciplines. We have picked out some of the interesting books in the collection for you. The City in History, Its Origins, Its Transformations, and Its Prospects by Lewis Mumford. Happy City, Transforming Our Lives Through Urban Design by Charles Montgomery. Triumph of the City, How Our Greatest Invention Makes Us Richer, Smarter, Greener, Healthier, and Happier by Edward Glaser. The Image of the City by Kevin Lynch.
We house a data library that allows access to and archives the most up-to-date socio-economic data available in India related to urbanization from the National Sample Survey and Annual Survey of Industries and Census data. The IHS library also has a great cartographic collection with over 700 maps and atlases. We have geological and mineral maps from the National Atlas and Thematic Mapping Organization. Our collection of the Survey of India as open series maps, state maps, district planning map series, guide maps, tourist maps. We also have old maps of Bangalore from the British Library and some beautifully illustrated city maps.
We have an ever-growing collection of fiction and non-fiction books. We have a lovely children's lit section which has some wonderful illustrated books and graphic novels. The library accepts in-kind donations from the personal libraries of individuals. Our current collection includes those of N.S. Ramaswamy, Xerxes Desai, Almitra H. Patel, and Devaki Jain. Thanks to one of our donors, we also have collections from Planning Commission of India. We believe in creating a culture of collaboration where libraries across the country can share their knowledge and best practices with each other. We organized a Librarians Roundtable in 2019, which brought together various community, academic, institutional, and reference librarians to discuss the ways of making libraries truly open and accessible to all.
We hold themed library exhibitions every quarter. These exhibitions include maps and movies on art and heritage in Indian cities. Our current exhibition is curated by Shreya K, who works with the IHS Media Lab along with the library team.
The exhibition that I have curated is titled Zooming In, Whose Lens Is It Anyway? It aims to explore the lives and works of some women and queer photographers and cinematographers from around the world. When it comes to photography and cinematography, the dominant narratives and works that are in focus have mostly been determined by people who occupy the top rungs of various power structures, be it race, caste, class, and gender. One of the interesting aspects of the IHS library is the space it provides for researchers to explore these narratives by subverting the heteronormative way of seeing and bringing multiple lenses to better understand these forms.
Along with the World Lab, we also host public text every month, where we bring authors to talk about their latest work and engage with the audiences. We also work closely with neighborhood schools, where we encourage students to visit the library and conduct book reading. In the past, we have conducted the Public Libraries Walk as part of the City Scripts, our annual writing festival, to encourage people to visit libraries and also bring the library community together. And we want to continue creating experiences like this, even if it is online.
I hope you enjoy the tour. If you'd like to learn more about the library and its facilities, you can find all the information on our website. And if you have any other queries, please write to us at library@ihs.ac.in. We hope to see you soon.
Hello, everybody. So the library team is here. My name is Pradeep, and my colleagues Amrut and Vinay are here. So we are very quickly going to take you through further discussion. And so starting off with COVID reflections and the... we worked mostly, the IHS library was so mostly through the lockdown period, and we... when the lockdown announced unexpected, we started to work remotely, and our services were mostly remote and more digital services that we attended to. And also in the process, we had more electronic access requests that have come. And by mid-June, the staff started to join into the work. And given the team were mostly all not based in Bangalore, and so once we started to work, we started to introduce a token system, and we had minimum contact, and across our Delhi and Chennai and Bangalore locations, all the six of the team members were working, and and eventually the fellows, urban fellows, have joined us by October, and then the library external members. We started to allow them to access the library only on Saturdays since November. And so to come to the aims of the library, we support the IHS in its academic research pursuits to build the largest reference library on urbanization. And we are a public reference library. So we create a knowledge base of urban-centric resources and information services. And we build and strengthen the existing resources to have a world-class library on urbanization and augment it through the IT infrastructure. So coming to the collections, IHS has a hybrid collection of print and electronic resources, more than 24,000 of maps, data, films, books, census records, cartographic materials, and more. And so so more specifically about it, Amrut will take us through.
Hello, everyone. IHS library has discipline-specific multilingual, city-centric fiction and children's books. About our language collections, we have over 500 books in Indian languages. Kannada collections include more than 400 books. Notable authors among them are H.G. Radhadevi, Triveni, M.K. Indira, Anupama Niranjan, Usha Navaratna Rao, Tarasu, etc. And we are started building on Telugu and Tamil language book collection as well. We have over 700 maps and atlases of various scales, and we have census records since 1991. Maps collections cover open series maps, state maps, tourist and guide maps, district planning map series from Survey of India, National Atlas, and thematic mapping organization has district and geological maps for districts and regions. We also have thematic atlases on risks, water, disasters, and vulnerability, arts, culture, heritage, and so on. We have access to unique 66 print journals and magazines, and over 1,200 geospatial data collections from the National Sample Survey and Census Office. Our documentary films cover the themes such as water, sanitation, poverty, gender, social movements, climate change, housing, and music. Databases on socioeconomic indicators and legal information are Economic and Political Weekly, India Times Series, Manupatra, India Stat, and CapEx. Over 21,000 electronic books and reports from multiple sources are made available. Teaching aids and software include EndNote, Mendeley, Stata, and Turnitin. Over to Vinay.
Yeah. Hello, everyone. So IHS Knowledge Gateway holds over 800 plus publications. Those are like faculty publications. Those includes monographs, case studies, policy papers, advisors, and etc. So all these publications are openly accessible on our Knowledge Gateway platform. So reference support. We provide specialized reference support, especially around urban theme. And also we have provided reference support to IPCC authors on climate change research over the couple of years. Library membership. So our IHS library is open to the public since 2014. And currently we have over 60 memberships, library memberships. So our library members are privileged with borrowing 3 books a month, and we are providing view-only access to all our electronic resources within the IHS premises. We are planning to open to public from April onwards. We'll get back to us.
And if you have any questions, please write to us at library@ihs.ac.in. And that's all about.
Keep the camera on. Okay, no problem.
I'll close it. Thank you. Great. So, if there are no questions, we'll close this session. Thank you to everybody who attended. This was one of our most favorite and most fun sessions. We're glad we could bring some libraries to you, to your living rooms or wherever you're watching it. We'll take a short break now. Join us again at 6 o'clock on the same link. We're doing an interesting experiment with audio and a sensorial experience of the Lodhi Gardens. Thank you.